Welcome back to our new series called What Would Richard Say, where our alumni and folks that join us on our Wednesday night Zoom meeting get a chance to request a topic that I would then talk about. The last request we got was for me to talk a little bit about codependency. So this next 20 minutes will be on codependency. Before we actually get into the codependency issue, we want to make sure that everyone understands that codependency is an addiction. It's a dependence like any other. Therefore, it falls under the definition of an exaggerated need that is difficult to manage and creates problems. So what is codependency born out of? What is codependency medicating? Because all dependencies and addictions medicate something. Well, in my opinion, codependency is about medicating the need to be loved because a person is having a difficult time accessing their self-love. And the more you have difficulty accessing your self-love, which would enable you to be comfortable being alone, it would enable you being comfortable making known what your needs are to other people without fearing retribution or fearing that you'll be abandoned or not loved in return. It also means that you understand that you're not there to save everyone around you. Being able to access self-love is something that we aspire to in recovery. But when you don't have access to your self-love, then, of course, you need to turn outside of yourself and try to fill that void, try to fill that. And that's what codependency is all about. And it can come across in a couple of different ways. The two main ones, of course, are either I make myself overly responsible for someone else's welfare and happiness and contentment, meaning that it becomes my responsibility to make sure that the other person feels loved and wanted and desired and that they are safe and that they will have a good life. It's my responsibility. And if for whatever reason they're unhappy, it must be my fault. What did I do? What could I have done better? What could I have done differently? That's one form of codependency. The other form of codependency, of course, is needing to be loved by someone else. And therefore, being afraid to voice my needs, being afraid to be able to be honest about what I want in a relationship, what I need in a relationship, for fear that the other person will not love me or will leave me and will not want me. So there are unmet needs that we've accumulated along the way as we're growing up, either in childhood or early adolescence, late adolescence. There are needs that were not met properly, and there are abilities that we did not develop to fulfill our own needs, to meet our own needs. Someone once said, the best time to be in a relationship is when you don't need to be in one, because you're then absolutely free to be yourself. If the other person chooses to terminate the relationship, it's okay. It kind of reminds me of, gambling in the sense that, or negotiation, they say, you shouldn't sit at the table if you can't get up and leave. If you can't get up and leave, you shouldn't be there in the first place. But the lines with love and being loved and being loving get murky. Sometimes it's cultural. There are certain cultures that firmly believe that parents should sacrifice themselves completely and fully and totally for the next generation. And they will bleed themselves in order to make sure that their children have opportunities that they did not have. And they will do everything they can to save their children from their mistakes. I mean from the children's mistakes, from their own mistakes. And it's just part of their definition of what love is. So love is, you know, you get up at 6 a.m. and you open up the kitchen and you will now run a short order kitchen for anyone that wakes up after you in the household. This one wants eggs, the other one wants a sandwich, the other one wants a bowl of cereal, the other one wants oatmeal. And in your definition of love, it is that you will make everyone their own favorite little thing for breakfast. Because that's what you believe love is, taking care of people. And so where do we draw the line of codependency? And I guess the whole dynamic is played out in the need to do it. I remember one time having a discussion with a fellow that had interviewed Mother Teresa, and we were discussing whether or not her life was, you know, truly altruistic, or was there a level of codependency to sacrifice yourself for the need of others. And we had to come to the conclusion that it's not codependency if you're doing it freely, if you're doing it willingly. In other words, imagine that there's a group of people running away from danger. And the only way that everyone's going to get to safety is if one of them stays behind to perform a certain task that will enable everyone else to be saved. And so this person sacrifices themselves, gives the ultimate gift, their life. In that case, we don't call it suicide. We don't say, oh, this person committed suicide for the well-being of others. We will say this person sacrificed themselves as a gift to the others so that the others could get to safety. And that's an important point because it all gets played out, I guess, in the intent. What is your intent and how free do you feel in doing it? If you feel that you're compelled and that you must do it and you cannot be at peace or at ease with yourself unless you do it, unless you sacrifice yourself, unless you put the needs of others ahead of your own, if that's the situation, then perhaps there's some codependency. But if you're doing it freely, willingly, and you're doing it because you want to, not because you feel you have to, then I would be hard-pressed to say that there's codependency involved. So, in order for it to be codependency, the measuring stick for me is it medicating? By doing it, is it removing a discomfort, an inner discomfort? If I refuse to do it, will it heighten some internal anxiety? Will it increase my fear of not being loved or my fear of being rejected or not wanted? Why am I doing it? And even in the simplest situations, if I'm sitting beside my wife and we're watching TV and I'm getting up to go to the kitchen to get myself and I ask her, would you care for something from the kitchen? And I'm doing it out of love and kindness, as I'm getting up anyways to go to the kitchen, that would not be considered codependency. But if I feel guilty about something that I did or said during the day, and there's still some residual tension between us as we are sitting beside each other watching a movie, and I I'm getting up to go to the kitchen and I'm going to ask her if she wants something, but what's really going on inside me, and only I know this, what's really going on inside me is I want her to forgive me and I want to be nice and I want her to accept whatever I'm going to bring her as a gift, so to speak, and I'm trying to be nice here and trying to, you know, patch things up and whatnot. Then that would fall under my appreciation of what codependency is. Because I'm going to be doing this, not of the kindness and sweetness in my heart of doing something nice for my wife, but I'm going to be doing it because it'll somehow medicate an inner discomfort. Which brings me to the idea that all of these process addictions, you know, whether it be food or sex or gambling or taking risks, workaholism, codependency, all of these process addictions, you know, these behavioral addictions and dependencies, I guess we don't necessarily have the luxury as we do with chemical dependencies of choosing abstinence. Well, that's a pretty easy one. You either drink alcohol or you don't. You know, there's no real gray area here. Oh, I suppose if you go to a restaurant and you order the house cappuccino without asking what it is, and the house cappuccino happens to have some Kahlua in it, and you didn't know, and you take a sip and you realize it, and you're an alcoholic in recovery, well, then the thing is, put the coffee aside, don't take another sip, and ask for a regular cappuccino. I don't consider that a relapse. Although, with a little bit of time, you develop the wisdom to ask, hey, what is this house cappuccino? What's it got in it? If they say, oh, it's just a coffee blend that is our, you know, blend here, oh, okay. So, chemical dependencies, put the plug in the jug, stop taking, stop using, that's pretty straightforward, right? Easy. But with process addictions, with behavioral dependencies and addictions, it's a little bit more murky because I don't know if it's always a question of complete abstinence from codependency. I've been in recovery for 40-some years. I'm 63 years old. I came into recovery in 1978. Codependency just started being talked about in 1979. The first person I remember talking about it was a woman by the name of Sharon Wakeshider, when she was still married to Don Wakeshider, and she got some of her work published through Hazelden's publication company at Hazelden in Minnesota. And it was good work. And then others continued and looked into that and added their wisdom and knowledge and understanding and all. But fundamentally, I've been practicing recovery for quite some time, and I got to tell you, to this day, the whole idea of having to do daily inventory and to ask myself, why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? If I behave a certain way with an employee, why am I doing it? I could be doing it because I know what the law is, and the law says that you got to do this a certain way, and that's it. That's the way I got to do it. Or am I doing it because I feel sorry for this employee or I feel bad for the employee and I take it upon myself to somehow try to help out? And when I do that, am I doing it because I feel compelled to do it, like I have to? Or am I doing it really because I want to be a nice guy and I do it freely? I don't feel I have to do it, you know? That's the whole issue here with codependency, is why am I doing it? Even in something as simple as saying to someone, I love you. Why did I say it? And I know when I say it because I really genuinely have a moment of love for someone and I tell them, or if it's because I'd like to hear it back from them. Sometimes I'll say it because I want to test the waters and to see, are we okay? Years ago, my wife and I watched this movie with Tom Cruise called Oblivion, science fiction movie, futuristic thing. And he's paired with this woman, and together they make a team. And when they report to their boss, they have to let the boss know, are they still an effective team? So one of the measuring sticks that my wife and I have these days is, you know, when we feel that there might be some residual tension between us about some issue, we'll ask, are we still an effective team? And it kind of breaks the ice and makes us both laugh and smile and giggle a bit and allows us an entry point to discuss what needs to be discussed. But the whole idea here is, why am I saying I love you to someone? Or why am I going to help? And that has to do with either the ego or the identity. And then people say, well, how do you know? How do you know which one it is? My simplest way of checking myself is to remember that ego wants to impose, and my identity wants to contribute. Doesn't need to impose. It doesn't need to conquer. It doesn't need to be right. It just wants to contribute as best as it can. And it's open to the possibility that there's a better way. Ego is different. Ego wants to conquer. Ego wants to be right. Ego wants to say, my way of thinking is the right way of thinking, and you're absolutely wrong. Too bad for you, because somehow I know better. And I know how many times I've given someone advice that they asked for and still felt somewhat slighted or offended when I realized that they didn't take my advice. Isn't that amazing? How my ego is involved in advice giving, and I'm going to give someone advice that they asked for. I really try. I'm not as good as I would want to be, but I really try not to give advice unless I'm asked for it. And when I do, I can tell when my ego's involved, because I'll get somewhat offended, kind of like, well, why didn't they take my advice? Why did they ask me if they're not going to take my advice? Well, they should have taken my advice, because after all, I know way better than anyone else on how this should be. Whereas when I'm contributing from my identity, which in a fellowship we often call, you know, sharing your strength and hope, your wisdom, strength and hope. When you're just sharing your experience and what worked for you, and you're offering it as a gift to the other person, let me share with you what worked for me. I don't know if it'll work for you, but it worked for me, and this is what I did, and this is how I did it, and this is why I did it, and it worked for me. So when I'm sharing out of that level, I'm all okay with the idea that it might not be appropriate for you, or that you might find a different way, or you're going to do it differently. You're going to do it your way, whatever. It's okay. It's okay. It doesn't bear on me the fact that you choose to do something differently from what I've suggested. So codependency, I think, very often is part of that ego's imposition. I know better than you what's good for you, and I'm going to tell you how you should live because I know more and I know better than you what's good for you. Or the ego says, you need to take care of me. I'm unhappy and it's your fault. You make me angry. You make me unhappy. You make me nervous. You raise my anxiety level. It's all you, and you need to change that. You need to make me feel good and make me feel secure. You know? Most amazing thing. And I've had friends like that. I've had sponsees. I've even had employees that, my God, I did not know what else I could do to make them feel important, valued, needed, a member of the group with job security, because that's the problem. When I am needy of love, the problem is it's never satisfying. You cannot give me enough love for me to be satisfied. When one is needy, there is no satisfaction. Now, the other issue about codependency is, of course, our ability to love ourselves, to be loving with ourselves. Because it's going to be very difficult for a person to believe, to trust, that someone else can love you more than you love yourself. After all, you know yourself more than anyone else. You know your deep dark secrets, you know your deep shames, you know your guilts, you know what you've done wrong, you know your quirky way of thinking. You know yourself at a way more intimate level than anyone else will ever know you. And so, if they say to you they love you, and you don't love yourself, or on a scale of 1 to 10, you love yourself 3.5, but are offering you love at 7.5, that extra 4 points is useless to you almost. Sure, you like it, you appreciate it, but you don't trust it, because there's no foundation for it. So one of the components of recovery from codependency is to come to love yourself. And not love yourself in a self-centered, narcissistic way, but to truly love yourself in a sense of being good to yourself, taking care of yourself, nurturing yourself, supporting yourself, encouraging yourself, praising yourself. Are you willing to try that? To love yourself? Because the more you're willing to embrace your responsibility to finish, for lack of a better term, parenting yourself. And let's remember, I mentioned earlier that codependency is all based on needs, unmet, exaggerated needs. Some of them may have taken root in childhood, adolescence, young adulthood. These needs can only be fulfilled by you, for you, from within you. You can go look for it outside of yourself, hoping that you find someone that will love you. And it is important that we are willing to learn to love ourselves through the eyes and hearts of others. That's a bridge. It's not the final destination. That's just a bridge. The real issue is to love yourself. And a lot of people, when they hear love yourself, they think that it means that right away you're going to think you're great, and you're going to think you're an extraordinary person, and you're going to think that, wow, you know, you are such hot stuff. No, that's not what I'm talking about at all. Loving yourself means, how can you demonstrate that you appreciate who and what you are, that you value your own talents and abilities, that you're willing to make the effort to develop those talents and abilities. It doesn't mean you're good at them right away, but it means that you're willing to explore what it is about you that is lovable. You're willing to explore that. What is it about you that's lovable? What is it about you that another person could truly appreciate and love? You need to discover that about yourself and nurture that within yourself. Because when it comes from you, from within you, there's a level of security that comes with it. I don't need to be told by other people that I'm a generous man. I know I'm a generous man because I want to be a generous man. I don't need to be told that I am a loving man. I know I'm a loving man because I choose to be loving. I want to be loving. It didn't come easy. I didn't like people at first. When I came into recovery, I used to joke about it and tell people that I thought I had something in common with Superman, in the sense that I was banished to live the rest of my existence on this planet surrounded by microbrains. I didn't like people. I thought people were just so silly and stupid and just like, what the hell is wrong with people? And then to my great surprise, I realized how flawed I was. And I keep saying it to this day, that the greatest gift that recovery gave me was that I came to be at peace with the idea that I am Mr. Flawed, living on planet Flawed, surrounded by flawed people, and it's okay. It's a great place. I'm growing. I love it, you know. And then I got to choose, what kind of a person do I want to be? Not what I want to do, not what I want to have. That's ego. What do I want to be? I want to be sweet. I want to be kind. I want to be funny. I like being funny. I'm not always as funny as I'd like to be, but I like to be funny. I like to laugh. I love telling stories. I still have the idea that there's a movie script inside me that I will one day get out of me somehow. I love telling stories. I love empowering people. I love helping people discover that it's possible to live a good, loving life. I like to help people discover that it's not important if you are loved. And I'd like for them to know that if you choose to be loving, you don't have to worry about being loved. Am I as good at it as I would like to be? No. No. Am I working on it? Yep. So, what is it about you that you would like to develop, that you would like to enhance? What qualities would you like to have so that you can say, this is who I am? And I might not be as good at it as I'd like to be, but I'm working on it. Loving yourself doesn't start with you being lovable. Loving yourself is a choice to give yourself a gift that will render you lovable. Some people wait until they become lovable. No, it's the other way around. So the recovery from codependency. Recovery from codependency is not to say I don't need anyone or I don't want anyone and I'd rather be alone. Recovery from codependency is all about being able to be with someone else within balance. Where I am with you because I choose to be with you, not because I have to be. And I love you, not because I'm afraid that if I don't, I'll never find another. No, I just happen to love you. And there could be another person that I could love as much. So, should something happen to you, I might be at your funeral, and then I'll move on with my life. It sounds silly to say it that way, but codependency is an addiction, and like any other addiction, it shackles people. It ties them to what they're addicted to, and they can't let go. Codependency is the same. So the recovery from codependency is not making the choice that I will be alone, but it is making the choice that if I should be alone, it's okay. I can let go. I can let go. It doesn't have to be you. It doesn't have to be you, the one I will love, and it doesn't have to be you, the one I demand loves me. It's okay. You know, it's okay. I love myself enough to enjoy spending time alone. Do I prefer to be in the company of others? Yes. But it's okay. So, recovery from codependency. I know that a lot of people put a lot of emphasis on setting boundaries and, you know, the proper boundaries and staying on your side of the sidewalk and making sure that your side of the sidewalk is good and so on and so forth. And, you know, I got to tell you, all of that is good advice and it has its place, absolutely. But for me, fundamentally, recovery is when you have given yourself the freedom of saying, I don't want to be addicted to this. I don't want to have an exaggerated, maladaptive need that's difficult to manage and will cause me problems. I don't want that. So, what kind of relationship do I want? A relationship that is not codependent is a relationship that is based on two people who choose to be together because they like each other and love each other enough to say, I'd like to share my life with you and I'd love to share your life. And that's what it's about, sharing. Sharing of responsibilities, sharing choices, sharing decisions, sharing goals, sharing our souls, sharing our wisdom, sharing everything that we can. And should that relationship need to end because the other person decides to go another path, I can wish them well. I can say to them, if ever you need support to go your own path, you let me know. If you need to go, please, don't worry about me. That's the freedom that we're looking for in the recovery from codependency. So, is this the answer to all that we need to know about codependency? Of course not. I invite you to read as many books as you can on it from as many different authors. There are a lot of different angles on it, and a lot of different ideas are shared, and there's little nuggets of wisdom in everyone's work. But if I can leave you with one thing, it would be, why? Why do I need to be with this person? Why does this person need to be with me? Why? Answer the why as honestly as you can. And if the answer is not as clean as it should be, it doesn't mean you gotta throw it away, it just means clean it up. Simple. So, I wish you wonderful relationships, whether it be a relationship with a romantic relationship, someone that you love intimately, whether it be an employee, you know, I know a lot of bosses that have codependent secretaries, oh my God. You know, when you're codependent, it doesn't just show up in one place, does it? So I wish you good relationships, healthy, growing relationships. Not relationships that have no problems, but relationship where there's an intent and a commitment to work on it and grow and work and grow. So, that's what I've got to say about this. See you next time.